It's great to be here, especially since this time tomorrow I will be on a plane to New York, which is expecting 18 inches of snow. So this is a very pleasant respite before that. Wish I could stay here instead. I should say a couple of things before I get started. First of all, I understand that 10 o'clock in the morning is not necessarily the best time to give a speech in Athens. I apologize to all of you for dragging you out here so early. It is entirely my fault because of my travel schedule. This was really the only time I could do it. Wish I could have done it later. The second thing I should tell you, because that introduction, while extremely flattering, may have raised expectations to an unrealistic level. I should tell you that I have never worked a day in my life as a public relations person. That will, of course, for some of you, raise the question of why I have the infernal hubris to stand up here on a stage and lecture you about your business when I've never actually done it myself. The only thing that I can say in my defense is a quotation that, being a journalist, I stole from somebody else without ever bothering to give it attribution. But somebody very smart once said, if you steal ideas from one person, it's plagiarism. If you steal ideas from more than one person, it's research. I have now been writing about public relations for a little more than 30 years. And over the course of 30 years writing about this business, I have stolen ideas from probably thousands of people. Many of those people probably include some of your bosses. I've stolen ideas from Harris Diamond and Jack Leslie and Andy Polanski. I know the Hill and Knowlton folks are here. I've stolen lots of ideas from a succession of CEOs at Hill and Knowlton, including Jack Martin and Lars Eric here in Europe. If there's anybody from Ogilvy here, I've been stealing ideas from Chris Graves at an alarming rate over the last year and a half or so. So some of what you're going to hear in the next 45 minutes is the fruits of that research. And hopefully it'll all make sense to you as I weave it into a narrative. And I want to start by saying that because I'm a journalism sort of professional, and my background is in reporting, nearly everything I say has to be delivered in this sort of good news, bad news format. The good news is going to be that for a variety of reasons, public relations is more important, more vital, more strategic, hopefully at the end of the day, more lucrative today than it has ever been in the past, and I'm going to discuss some of the reasons why I believe that to be true. The bad news is that as public relations becomes more and more important, there are worrying signs that public relations people could get left behind. We are entering into an era where what we do is so important that many companies are reluctant to trust it to public relations people. And I think we have to acknowledge that that's happening, understand how we need to change because that's happening, and then make some adjustments to the way we think and the way we act in order to ensure that as public relations becomes more important, we're the people doing it. And I'll get to that in the second half of the presentation. But let's talk a little bit about what's happening in the world right now. The big story for the last sort of 10 years, from my perspective, and I'm sure from the perspective of many of your clients, is the way in which digital and social media have transformed the communications landscape. I'm fond of saying in presentations like this that for marketing people, digital and social media changed everything. Because what happened in the marketing realm over the last 10 years is that the old wisdom was turned on its head. 10 years ago, if you were a marketing executive, you could proceed on the assumption that the brand was everything you told people about your company. So the brand was defined by the things that you said. The brand was defined by your advertising, by your website, by your sponsorships, even by your press releases. But the brand was yours and you told people what it stood for. That is clearly no longer the case. Today, the brand isn't what you tell people about yourself. The brand is what people tell each other about you. The brand today is not defined by your ads and your sponsorships and your websites. It's defined by the millions of conversations that are taking place every day about your products and services, about your culture, about your corporate social responsibility, about your interaction with the world. And those conversations are not something that you as a marketer can control. Those conversations are out there. Some of them are happening online where you can see them. Some of them are happening at cocktail parties, in the hairdressers, at dinner meetings between people. But they're happening out there in the world, and they are shaping your brand more than ever. So for marketers, I believe digital and social media changed everything. For public relations people, no, let me make a small change. For good public relations people, digital and social media have changed nothing. Okay? The things that were important to good public relations before digital and social media came along are the things that are still important today. Transparency, authenticity, credibility, trust, integrity, conversation, dialogue. These are the bedrock principles on which the public relations profession either has always operated or should have always operated. Every campaign that we created had to be about credibility and trust, had to be about conversation and dialogue. We are used to interacting with outsiders. We are used to communicating directly with stakeholders and having them communicate back to us in exactly the same way. Digital and social media have just given us new improved tools with which to do that. But they haven't, as long as you were doing it the right way to begin with, fundamentally changed what we do. And so suddenly, I believe what we do is more important than ever. I need to step back here for a second and explain exactly what it is I think we do, and where exactly I think public relations fits into the world, because I suspect that my view on this will be slightly different than the conventional wisdom that you've heard over the years, and will also be slightly different from the way in which many of your clients view the role of public relations. So, let me start by acknowledging the reality that in most organizations, there are two important functions that deal with relationships between an organization and its stakeholders. There is the marketing operation, which in most companies is responsible primarily or exclusively for the relationship between an organization and its consumers. And there is the corporate communications, corporate affairs, very rarely these days public relations function, which is responsible for all the other stakeholder groups. So somewhere in that corporate communications function, you have somebody who's responsible for employee communications, somebody who's responsible for shareholder communications, somebody who's responsible for public affairs and government communications, and somebody who's responsible for reputation and maybe CSR. And This is where I suspect I'm going to start to depart from the conventional wisdom. By the way, I should say, this would be a lot easier if I had a PowerPoint presentation behind me. I suck at PowerPoint. I don't like PowerPoint. I did create a PowerPoint presentation for this, but before I got here, I thought I was going to give a totally different presentation. And it was only in talking to people downstairs that I decided that this was the direction I was going to go in. And so what you're getting now is entirely improvised. And so no PowerPoint. But if I had PowerPoint, it would have corporate communications up here and all of those different stakeholder groups. And then it would have marketing up here and that one stakeholder group that they're responsible for. And then down at the bottom here, it would have all the channels through which corporate communications and marketing communicate with those stakeholders. And in these little boxes that you are now hopefully imagining at the bottom of my imaginary PowerPoint slide, there are things like advertising and sponsorships and websites and social media channels and earned media. Okay, this is where I'm going to go completely off track in terms of public relations, because there is a view that has come to be prevalent in our industry that that last imaginary box down there that says earned media is where public relations belong. That public relations is the discipline of earned media. That public relations is, if you like, either media relations or product publicity. If that's your view, and you're happy with that view as the driving force for your career, and it's what you want to do for the rest of your life, this might be a good time to leave the presentation, because I don't see public relations that way, and I've never seen public relations that way. So, I think that we have, by allowing ourselves to be defined in terms of earned media, dug public relations into a hole where the scope of its activity and its ability to contribute to the organization are severely limited. If you can go back to imagining my chart again, with corporate communications, marketing, all the channels, all of the stakeholder groups, I believe that where public relations belongs is way up at the top of that chart. I think that, I'm a journalist, okay? One of the things as a journalist that you sort of have to believe is that words have meaning. To me, the words public relations have a pretty clear meaning. Public relations is the discipline that manages the relationship between an organization and every single member of the public with whom it interacts. So first of all, if you accept that definition, marketing is a subsidiary of public relations. Marketing should, in a sane and rational world, report to public relations. Public relations is about managing all of your relationships. Marketing is about managing one of them. Public relations is about managing every stakeholder group. Marketing is about managing one of them. Public relations is not defined. The end product of public relations is not a press release. The end product of public relations is not a news story. The end product of public relations, because of the name, is a relationship. That's the objective of public relations, to forge relationships with consumers, with employees, with shareholders, with regulators. Maybe, yes, with the media, but the media, frankly, only helpful as a conduit to all of those other stakeholder groups, not as an end in itself. And I believe that because of what's going on in the world, we are beginning to see that function of public relations take shape. We are beginning to see organizations looking at the world and saying, we need a group, we need somebody inside our organization operating at the very highest level, who is responsible for managing our relationships with internal and external audiences. To a certain extent, this is happening because in the social media world that I've discussed, all of those relationships are interactive and converging. So, for example, If you are a marketer today who wants to build great relationships with your consumers, you probably have to start with employees. Like it or not, and in many cases I suspect it's very clearly not, like it or not, your employees are brand ambassadors. Every time they interact with somebody, on the job or off, they are communicating something about what your company stands for, what its culture is like, what its values are like. They are out there in the world interacting with people and helping to shape both your brand and your reputation. So if you're a marketer today and you don't care about the employee audience, you don't try to turn your employee audience into good brand ambassadors, you're only doing about half your job. If you're a marketer today and you don't think about corporate social responsibility, you're only doing half your job, because we've entered into an era in which how companies behave, what they do, how they interact with the world around them has a fundamental impact on their brand. A lot of my examples, unfortunately, are going to be drawn from the US, but in the US, for example, we've seen brands stepping into controversy and in some cases coming out ahead because they are suddenly, in the age of Trump, being forced to live their values. It was quite easy a year ago for companies to say things like, yes, we support diversity and inclusion, we believe diversity and inclusion are important principles. Suddenly today, diversity and inclusion are very, very unpopular at the very highest level of government. If you are tolerant and accepting of gays in the workplace, suddenly you're on the Trump shit list. There's no reason to believe that tomorrow morning he's not going to tweet out something about what a horrible company you are. And so suddenly you actually have to put your money where your mouth is. You have to have the courage to stand up and be counted on these issues. And that can really impact your brand. Right now we have Republicans in America boycotting a whole number of brands that are perceived to be anti-Trump. Kellogg decided it was no longer going to advertise on Breitbart, the sort of right-wing hate site in America, and is being boycotted. Nordstrom decided that it was no longer going to carry Ivanka Trump's brand of very tacky women's clothing, and is suddenly, by the way, in case you haven't figured it out, I'm not a Republican. That will become more apparent as we go along. And I'm especially not a Trump Republican. But now, so you have companies now that are almost being forced to take political positions. If you as a brand manager don't understand the political realm and how your decisions will play out in the political realm, in Budweiser is the great example. Budweiser is a very Midwestern conservative with a small C company that during the Super Bowl this year ran an ad talking about the heritage of its founders. This ad was, I guess, a celebration of the immigrant culture of America. The founders of Budweiser, Anheuser and Busch, moved to America as immigrants from Europe. They faced a lot of difficulties as immigrants. They were persecuted when they first arrived in America. They triumphed over that persecution and created a beer which today is synonymous with America. Because it's weak and tastes like, no, because it's a quintessential Midwestern American beer. The amount of hate that was directed towards Budweiser because of this commercial was astonishing to me. You know, the people who drink Budweiser are heartland Americans, and they felt that by celebrating immigration, Budweiser was taking a political position. Even better example, I don't know, I'm going to blank on this. Has anybody, I don't know if the movie has even opened here yet, but there's a movie, I think it's called Hidden Figures, or it's about the women who worked at NASA and then later at IBM as, well, they were called computers in the early days. Their job was to compute before machines came along and did it for them. They were great technical pioneers. This movie is about four African-American women who worked as computers in those days. IBM has been bombarded with email messages claiming that this movie is fake news. There are people in America, a surprisingly large number of people in America, who actually believe that this story is made up. It must be made up because this was the 50s, and there's no way that black women in the 50s could have been in the computing business. And it's obviously propaganda designed to make black women look good and, by the way, make white people look bad because nobody else can gain anything unless we're having to sacrifice part of our fundamental identity. And so IBM, just by being part of this story that is a hit movie, has become the target for hate groups in America who want it to come out and make a statement that, no, these women never existed, it's not real, we just made it up because we're politically correct. So we're in this strange world where everything is political. So if you are a marketer today, you need to understand this stuff. So we are seeing the public relations and marketing functions get closer and closer together. I worry about what is happening inside corporations for our function. I know what's the split here? How many of you work in agencies? How many of you work in in-house PR departments or corporate communications departments? Wow, you are so outnumbered, guys. Not guys, actually. Ladies, you are so outnumbered here. that's kind of a good thing because what I'm going to say next is fairly depressing for people inside corporations. More and more, I worry that the in-house public relations function is going to be absorbed into marketing as marketing realizes that it needs to understand CSR and employee communications and public affairs and public policy. Because once marketing people understand that, I'm not sure what they need you for. And here's the thing. We see marketing budgets going up, corporate communications budgets going down. We do a global study on this every year, and there's no question that the trends are not in the opposite direction. I worry that corporate communications people as a whole are not either tough enough or aggressive enough or demanding enough to take control of their own function rather than cede it to marketing. I could spend a lot of time talking about what I think corporate communications as a function has done wrong. First of all, I hate the term corporate communications. Public relations, to me, is much bigger. You communicate by communicating. You build a relationship by behaving. Public relations, therefore, is about policy and behavior, whereas communications is merely telling people about your policy and behavior. So I think once we started calling ourselves corporate communications people, we gave up a lot of our power within organizations. I also think corporate communications people have spent far too much time playing defense, far too much time reacting to events, far too much time protecting, and not nearly enough time aggressively promoting the organization, proactively communicating, getting out there and telling stories in order to build reputation, in order to build brands. And so I do worry inside the corporation that that's going to have an impact on the status of corporate communications going forward. On the other hand, the agency environment, I think, is quite different. We should be worried about this, what's going on inside, I think, for a couple of reasons. Here's what I think is worrying if you're in the PR agency business. The first thing that's worrying is there's a group of people inside the organization, those two people over there, those two lonely souls on the left-hand side of the room, who really understand what it is you do and what it is you bring to the party and why you're so important. And their budgets are shrinking like crazy. And then there's a group of people inside the corporation whose budgets are growing and who are getting more and more power. And they have no clue what you do. They have no clue why you're important. They think that you're just a cheaper version of advertising. And the time has come for the public relations agency business to kick in the doors of those people and explain to them what the value that you bring to the table is and why it is fundamentally different than the value that anybody else is bringing to the table. You need to explain to them that public relations is and always has been about those things that I was talking about earlier: transparency, integrity, credibility, trust, conversation, dialogue. And you need to explain to them that today, credibility and trust are by far the most important things in building their brand. That it is no longer enough to bombard people with a message until they eventually surrender and say, okay, you've hit me with 30 ads today, I'll just buy your shit if you'll go away. You need to build relationships. You need to build an emotional bond with people. You need to show them that you understand their lives and their needs and focus on them. And you don't do that. My favorite story on this, by the way, was a few years ago. The people who send out direct mail, right? So everybody here gets direct mail either in their email inbox or through their actual physical letterbox. And if you're anything like me, your immediate reaction is either to delete, hit the junk button, or in the physical sense, throw it in the trash. This is what I think is funny about the direct mail people. About 10 years ago, they decided that they would rebrand themselves. And they chose as the term to rebrand themselves, relationship marketing. I don't know how most of your relationships work, okay? But if I suddenly started sending you I'm sorry, I'm swearing a lot in this presentation, by the way. I'll try and rein it in a little. If I suddenly started sending you crap that you don't want, and I did it over and over again, and I bombarded your inbox with this stuff, and I started knocking on your door and handing it to you as you opened the door. That is only a relationship if you consider stalking to be a form of love, right? I mean, this is not how a person behaves if they want to forge a relationship with you. This is how a stalker behaves if he wants to drive you crazy. I guess stalker marketing was taken. But here's the thing. This is our business. Relationship marketing is our business. There are a number of things that we need to do in order to prove to people that we can really deliver relationships. And I don't know how much time I have here, but I want to talk a little bit about sort of what I think the skills are that we need more of. And then I want to talk a little bit about the personal qualities that I think we are going to need going forward in order to really beat this down. And the first thing I want to talk about is data and analytics. This is last year's speech, so I'm not going to spend, because last year there was an edict that went around the entire communications business. If you give a speech about public relations, you have to talk about big data. And so I incorporated that into my presentation. So this is last year's speech on big data. Okay. I believe that the world is very, let me step back a second and talk about something else. The communications landscape, as I said earlier, has changed. The convergence that we're seeing in-house between marketing and corporate communications is happening outside of the organization in a totally different way, which is that suddenly PR firms are competing, sometimes for the same brief, with ad agencies, with digital firms, with social media specialists, and even at the top end of the value chain with management consulting firms. Management consulting firms think they can do change management. They think they can do corporate purpose. They think they can do some public policy communications. Reality is they're not very good at it. If there's anybody from a management consulting firm in the audience today, I apologize in advance. They're not very good at it. They overcharge. They overcomplicate. They're great at process. They suck at anything that involves human beings. Gross generalization. My favorite kind. So, public relations is competing with all of these people. Here's what I believe. Of all of those people, the person who has the best data will come up with the best insight. The person who comes up with the best insight will come up with the best strategy. The person who comes up with the best strategy will lead the communications efforts. And clients, I believe, are open-minded enough that if they get a brilliant idea from a PR firm, they will run with it, and the ad agency will have to get on board, and the digital firm will have to get on board. We are not great at insight, partly because, mostly because, we are not great at data. We need to understand big data better. If you do not in your agency have somebody with a title like Chief Data Officer, if you don't have somebody in your agency who has a really deep understanding of data and analytics, you are not going to be able to get there to the senior, to the lead position in the strategic, whatever, we used to call it the table, right? We have a seat at the table. The head seat at the table is not going to belong to somebody who doesn't get data and analytics. So we need data and analytics in our industry more than ever. We also need, and this is a sort of mystical black box to me, okay? But I know people who figured it out. We need people who can look at all of that data and derive from it the key strategic insight that will drive a brand platform. When Demetrius and I were driving over here this morning from my hotel, we were talking about Unilever. Somebody within Unilever or its marketing organization came up with this wonderful insight for their soap powders, which is dirt is good. Okay, that's a great insight. You look at the world, you find out how people are using your product, what consumers care about, and you come up with a notion like dirt is good. Or if you're, again, a lot of my good examples come from Unilever, you come up with a notion like real beauty, real women, and then you invest in it. Those are both, to me, essentially public relations ideas. They are ideas that have the relationship of your brand to its users at the very heart of them, and they are then executed in terms of advertising and PR and digital and social and everything else. But they are essentially PR ideas. I can almost guarantee you, only almost because there are more people who take credit for those ideas than could possibly have been involved, that PR was not the discipline that generated those ideas. Those were great PR ideas that came from somewhere else. That should worry us. Our ability to generate that kind of insight is going to be critical going forward. And by the way, just to come back to data for a second, there are two issues with data. There's a big data issue, which used to be an issue of economics. It used to be an issue of, if you had a big $100 million advertising budget, you could get hold of plenty of data. If you had a little $100,000 PR budget, it was very difficult. Data is much more democratic today. Data is much more freely available today. There are cheap, effective ways of getting massive amounts of data that simply didn't exist 10 years ago. But there's another form of data which I believe is just as important to that insight generation process. And that's what I guess I'd call small data or intimate data. And that is data that you as public relations people have better access to than anybody else. Because if you're doing your job properly as public relations people, you are immersed in the communities of people who buy your products or that you're trying to reach. If you're an employee communications person, you should be interacting with employees on a daily basis. If you're a consumer PR person, you should be out there talking to consumers, not in focus groups, which are phony and artificial, but in the real world, in chat rooms where fans of your brand are gathering in their hundreds to talk about how wonderful it is. There are forums in America where literally hundreds of thousands of people gather to discuss toilet paper. Okay? This is the least interesting product on the planet. And there are people out there who care passionately about it, who log in every day. I don't know if there's anybody here from the agency, but a couple of years ago, an agency in America ran a survey online asking people whether you should hang the toilet paper over or under. And 5 million people voted. 5 million people care enough about this topic to have an opinion. Okay, those people are all out there involved with and engaged with your brand, and you have to be engaged with them. And that leads me to another critical issue, which is good public relations people should be spending twice as much time listening than they are talking. That's why corporate communications has become such a millstone around the industry's neck, is because people think communicating and talking are the same thing. By the way, I always say that the reason I love public speaking is because I get to speak for now without some other asshole interrupting me all the time. So this is why I would make a lousy public relations person. But seriously, guys, listening, social listening and real-world listening are absolutely critical to this, because it will give you data and insight that nobody else has. The second area that we need to spend more time on, this was actually going to be the subject of my whole presentation before I got knocked off course by those crazy Greeks downstairs, is behavioral science and cognitive science. Okay, I'm not going to go into this in huge depth, because there are some articles appearing on our website this morning that will go into this in great, probably exhausting detail. But in the wake of recent events, I assume you've been keeping up, right? But so we had the Brexit vote in the UK, and then we had Trump in America. I don't know if you here in Greece have had any political turmoil in recent years, but if so, you'll understand what I'm talking about. It seemed like the world had gone slightly crazy. And I started asking myself questions like, why do people believe obviously fake news? Why do people buy into these crazy conspiracy theories? Hillary Clinton is running a child sex ring out of a pizza restaurant in Washington, D.C. Because if I was a high-placed politician and I wanted to run a secret child sex ring, I'd do it at a pizza restaurant. And people believe this. Some guy went to the pizza restaurant and started firing his gun in the air because he thought he was going to liberate the child sex slaves. Why do people vote against their economic self-interest? Why, when it's clear to all of us that poor urban and rural Americans would be so much better off in a democratic country, do they vote for Donald Trump? Why do people do so? All this strange behavior, and I wanted to answer those questions. And the answer is because our brains are pretty weird, okay? That's a technical term from cognitive science. We think with our hearts before we think with our heads. We develop a cultural affinity for a group and become tribal in our outlook. We start to reject clearly factual information that contradicts our pre-existing beliefs. And one of my favorite experiments that I came across in all of this was an experiment about what happened when you presented people who don't believe in climate change with all of the factual information about climate science. How many climate scientists agree that the same thing is happening? What the evidence shows in terms of temperature rises? I assume most of you will have guessed by now what happens. They become even more committed to their existing belief. You cannot change people's minds with facts alone. That is simply not how our brain accepts and processes information. And I used to give a speech in which I said, public relations people are Democrats and advertising people are Republicans. I don't mean that literally. What I mean is that public relations people, particularly in the issues management environment, seem to have this completely unfounded confidence that if they just make rational arguments, if they just show people the facts, if they just tell people reality, then people will change their minds. Advertising people understand that that's not how the world works. Advertising people understands that you have to start by telling stories. You have to start with a narrative. So when Obamacare came along, Democrats would put out releases saying 20 million more people now have insurance. And Republicans would find this one guy in Iowa who'd lost his insurance. And he would go on television and he'd cry, "Oh, it's so sad, I lost my insurance, my wife is, I have to pay more now." It didn't matter whether the story was true. The fact that it was one person, that it was a story about what had happened to them personally, was more powerful than the 20 million. Think of your own response to, I'm not saying all of you, but there are people in this room, right, who knew a couple of years ago that refugees were dying in large numbers as they tried to get out of Syria and elsewhere. You might even have known the number, but you didn't actually care about it until you saw the photograph of that little boy on the beach who drowned trying to get to Europe, being carried up the beach by a policeman. The fact of the matter is that that one story about that one boy was way more impactful, had way more effect on public opinion in Europe than all of the statistics. So we have to, as an industry, be better at telling those kinds of stories. We have to understand that unless you open somebody's heart first, their mind is going to remain pretty much locked tight. And to do that, we have to understand cognitive science better. Cognitive science is changing all the time. There are new studies, new developments, new ideas being floated. They all contradict a lot of the Enlightenment wisdom that we believe in as communicators. And we have to get better at that. And finally, I'm saying finally, but actually I'm hoping that I have time for another little bit after this. Finally, in terms of how we need to change, right? We have to get better at proving that what we do matters. And I believe that we need to have a paradigm shift in terms of what we're trying to prove. I said earlier that I thought that the end product of good public relations is a relationship. So naturally, I think that we ought to be trying to measure relationships when we prove that what we do works. Just so you're aware, we don't, okay? We run the largest public relations competition in the world. We get entries literally from every continent. We get entries from 60 to 70 countries a year. The standard of measurement for these entries, which are apparently the best work that is being done anywhere in the world, remains pretty sketchy. I would say that at least half still focus on how much media coverage we generated or how many Facebook likes we got or some other measure. How many people in the room are familiar with something called Net Promoter Score? Okay, that's encouraging. So I believe that Net Promoter Score or some variation on it is the best way to measure public relations. Net Promoter Score essentially divides the world into people who are advocates for your brand, your company, your positions, people who are detractors, critics of your company, its brands and positions, and people who are somewhere in the middle and don't really give a damn. I believe that every public relations campaign, whether we're talking to employees, shareholders, customers, communities, ought to be about increasing the number of people who are out there saying nice things about your company, ought to be increasing the number of people who are advocates for your company, increasing the number of people who are going into chat rooms and saying, "This company's great," and reducing the number of people who are going into chat rooms and saying this company sucks. We ought to be trying to move detractors into the middle, and we ought to be trying to move people in the middle into the advocacy arena. And every public relations program should be measurable on those terms, because there is plenty of evidence now that that kind of shift can drive a real change in corporate performance, in sales performance, in brand loyalty performance, in employee loyalty, in the kind of reputation you have and the ease you have of doing business in the world. As I think as public relations people, we ought to be moving in that direction, getting away from... The only reason that we count clips right, as far as I can tell, is because the advertising people do that in their own way. They talk about reach and frequency. And so we think we have to talk about reach and frequency so that marketers can compare what we do to what advertisers do. We ought to be telling them that advertisers actually, all this reach and frequency stuff is pretty much bullshit, and they shouldn't care about that. They should care about what I'm talking about, advocacy and detractors. And we should be telling them, no, you hold advertising to that standard. You show me an ad campaign that increases the brand advocacy for your company, that gets people out there recommending your company to others. You show me an ad campaign that has taken away huge swathes of detractors or critics from your company. That ought to be the standard that we're all being judged on. And I believe that if it was, you'd suddenly see a lot of advertising dollars pouring into PR, because I think PR is better at that than advertising. I think we are better at it than anybody. So, how much time do I have? Five? Okay, great. I'm going to do quick five things. I've talked about some of the skills we need. The skills actually are important, but I think character is more important. And I think that there are five things that you should look for when you're hiring public relations people that have more to do with their character than their ability. And if we're really lucky, I'm going to be able to remember all five of them. The first is courage. I believe that public relations, because it's about policy, because it's about how you behave as a company, because if you want to forge a relationship, you do it by behaving, not by talking. I believe that the most important quality for a public relations counselor is courage. You are sometimes going to be the only person in the room who says, wait a second, this is a bad idea, because it's going to destroy relationship value. And everybody else in the room is going to want to do it because it makes more money and it's operationally feasible, and the lawyer has no objection because it's not exactly illegal. And you're going to be the person in the room saying, listen, I know employees and customers better than anybody else here, and if you do this, you're going to really screw up. And that takes an immense amount of courage. So if you are going to be a public relations counselor and not just a communications order taker, you need courage. The second thing you need is curiosity. This is a business, it seems to me, that is constantly changing. The world around you is constantly changing. You need to immerse yourself in that world and have a thirst for new knowledge. The neuroscience stuff that I was talking about earlier is, I'm guessing for a lot of people in this room, new knowledge. Go out there and learn about this stuff. Learn the latest thinking on how the brain actually works. Learn new techniques for communicating. Learn new techniques of storytelling. Keep on top of what's going on in the popular culture, because the popular culture will either create great opportunities for you going forward, or worst case scenario, maybe major threats for your company going forward, and you need to understand them and be ahead of them. You have to be the most curious person in your organization. Empathy. The ability to not only hear what people are saying, but understand why they're saying it. One of the first books I ever read on public relations was called We're So Big and Powerful, Nothing Bad Can Happen to Us. And it's about what happens inside companies when everybody buys into the company narrative. And the thing is, this happens to great companies with strong cultures to a certain extent more than it happens to weak companies, because everybody is on the same page. The pharmaceutical industry, we're in the business of saving lives. We produce medications that make people's lives better, that keep them alive. And it's very easy to get from there to, if this person is criticizing us, he must be a really shitty person, because he doesn't want us to produce medicines that save people's lives or make people's lives better. So why should we listen to him? And suddenly, all criticism of the company becomes off limits. And if somebody is criticizing you, they're your enemy. And the reality is that there is lots of legitimate criticism that goes on in the world. And you, as a public relations person, ought to be the one person in the organization who says, you know what? I know we're making great products, but I understand where this person is coming from. It's very difficult for somebody who's earning $20,000 a year to pay $100,000 a dose for the new AIDS medication that we just produced. And so empathy is a vital part of this, too. Integrity. It is your job to make your organization more trustworthy and more credible. You cannot do that unless you are trustworthy and credible yourself. And that means that you have to be unrelentingly honest in the way that you communicate. You cannot start to take advantage of this fake news thing. You cannot use all the stuff that I talked about a few minutes ago in terms of cognitive science to manipulate people. You have to be absolutely trustworthy. And that is a critical factor for our industry today more than ever. And now, as I very easily predicted at the beginning of this, I've come up with four things, and I cannot for the fucking life of me remember the fifth. Let's see. Courage, curiosity, integrity. Ah! No, my last one. Empathy, I did, thank you. The last one, and this is incredibly important, and I say this with complete self-interest because it's the one thing that I'm pretty good at. Improvisation. Okay? We have moved into an era where, you know, Mike Tyson once said everybody has a plan till they get punched in the nose. As soon as you go to market with your strategy, brilliantly well thought out, pored over by senior executives for years and years, looking 5 years down the road with a real clear idea of where you want to be, somebody, I guarantee you, is going to punch you in the nose. And as soon as that happens, you need to be able to adjust. You need to be able to, on the fly, communicate in real time. Whether it's a crisis, whether it's an opportunity, whatever it is, improvisation is suddenly way more important than planning. We are living in a world of chaos. Look at where any of the countries that I've talked about today, America, the UK, Greece, were a decade ago, and where they are now. And if you can say to me with any degree of accuracy or honesty that you would have predicted that for all three countries, you're either a liar or a time traveler. Because honestly, the world doesn't work like that anymore. And that ability to improvise is critically important. As I said at the very beginning of this presentation, I believe that the opportunity for public relations people is greater than it has been at any point in our history. I think what we do is more mission critical today than it ever has been before. The one thing that really has changed for us as a result of digital and social media is if we get it wrong, if we screw this stuff up, we will be found out almost immediately, and we will be punished more severely than at any time in the past. And that means that what you do is critically important. It's not too important to be left to public relations people. It's too important to be done by anybody who is not a trained and skilled public relations professional. And your challenge is to become trained enough and skilled enough to add value to your company, to save your company's ass in this chaotic time, and to make public relations the function that it really can and should be with inside organizations. Thank you very much for your patience.